Hello and welcome to the Overly Animated Podcast, where we take animation seriously. We talk animated shows and movies here, especially Miraculous Ladybug and The Owl House. Find everything about us at overlyanimated.com. I am your host, Dylan Hysen, and today I'm joined by Michelle Ander.
Hello.
Allie Martin.
Hey.
And April Collins.
Hi there.
We have finally reached the end of The Owl House, the series finale, Watching and Dreaming. Aired yesterday for us on Saturday, and at night. We have not had that long to process here. Sunday afternoon, we're talking about it, so we're going to give you all of our raw reactions and thoughts to the end of The Owl House. I've been promised there'll be crying. We'll see if that happens.
I was promised tears.
That's like a reality show producer. Yeah, basically.
Yeah, I was promised tears.
Yes.
That's it. You're off the podcast. Get out of here.
That's how we should do it. Yeah, make sure you have seen this series finale of The Owl House. It is on YouTube in the U.S. at least. It aired on Disney. It's on Disney Plus in the U.S. at least. Other countries might vary. So come back after you've watched. We're going to be getting into spoilers right away for Watching and Dreaming. So let's get into what we thought. Michelle, I heard you just watched the finale. What did you think of it?
I'm like really sad I couldn't rewatch it because there was so, oh my god, this is a long one. I was like, oh, it's like 54 minutes. I was like, oh my god. But it was worth it to have the extra time. I mean, I feel like about halfway through, I just had this moment of like, oh my god, this is a really satisfying finale. This is so good. I feel so fed. And even though obviously not everything we speculated on was touched with in as much detail, I feel very, very okay with how things shook out. I got teary and emotional several times. I guess like only complaint, not enough Hootie, but when Hootie did come back, he had beautiful anime eyes, and that was so lovingly done. So a little bit of extra points back for that, actually. God, there were so many things. I think like the thing I really appreciated is that, like, you know, Luz has always been the main character, and she stayed pretty front and center for this finale, and I think that was ultimately the right choice. I felt really good about how the collector stuff was handled. And even though I didn't see Luz being the one to talk to the collector, I thought King was going to do that. I think ultimately it made sense. And it was still kind of a team effort because they all went around showing him like where they made memories. I feel like for surface level thoughts, I feel very, very happy with this. And I think like sometimes the best stories like leave you a little wanting and leave you like speculating a little more still. So I vastly prefer that as a way to go out than like trying to answer like too much and it feels too fast. So I think like they did a good job for sure.
Okay. Nice. Yeah. Well, we'll definitely come back to that. I think we're talking a little bit about that too in our speculation podcast. That's pretty interesting. But first, Allie, what did you think of the finale?
I mean, I was also, I feel very satisfied with how pretty much everything was handled. And I think that it's also, Michelle said this, that it's like nice that kind of a lot of our expectations were either subverted or just not touched on because it might have felt like it was too much. And I know it felt really like a movie, especially the way they just directed everything.
Yeah.
And obviously with the length. And I think if you try to jam too much into an hour, it could feel rushed. But none of this really felt rushed. I was very happy also about how the collector stuff was handled and Belos' whole deal. I really like that he was not redeemed because
it's all good, man.
I think we could get into like how like the message of this finale is and like very similar to others, but I think personally, I think it was wrapped up in the most satisfying way, like if you compare it to other shows, which obviously it's not fair to a point to do that, but the way it just like made Luz's like journey from the beginning to where it ended. It just felt like it, everything fell into place really nicely. Nothing felt out of character. I love the Huntlow and Rayda crumbs that we got. Lots. There were like three gay kisses, not just Lumity kisses. It was great. We're going to talk about King's dad. I'm not that I don't know how to feel. It's just like a little.
He has a strong look there.
Yes, I love that. I love that.
He was going for comfy chic.
He's a true dilf.
Yeah, I did. I was not very emotional. I feel like, and part of this is probably because I watched Ruby that day, and that was like a whole other trip. We're not going to talk about it. But I was just like so drained, and I did a rewatch today. And I feel more emotional, but it still really does not feel like it set in. Like, I feel like we're going to come back in a month for, like, the epilogue, where it's, like, they're in college and, spoilers, like, they're studying stuff. And, the time skip. Oh, my God, the epilogue was the most satisfying thing. It was fantastic. And Luz's beast form. Not beast form, a titan magic form. We'll get into it. But it was, like, very much 20 out of 10. Really pretty much stellar, perfect finale.
Nice. Yeah, let's do the emotion check. Allie gave us hers. Michelle, what was your emotional response?
I surprised myself by how like into the grief stage I got. very reminiscent of like, I mean, every show's different, but it did kind of feel like that bittersweetness of like the end of Steven. I'm just like, when you sit with the show long enough and you theorize long enough, you get to like an attachment place where hopefully if the ending feels good, you're still kind of like sad, even though it's happy. Mm-hmm. It's still kind of mournful. And I definitely felt that. I feel like that's like the thing that really got me is like at the very, very end when they all wave, they're like, bye. I'm like, oh my God, that's for us. Like that
really
clever
because it could also be interpreted like at the collector.
That's the intro.
First reason. Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but that's a good point. Yeah. What are we scaling this? Like, is there a emotional
on your level of trauma from 1 to 10? How much pain are you in right now?
Oh.
Maybe not trauma, but definitely high on the grief. Mourning grief. Maybe like an 8.7 on the grief scale. Yeah.
Okay, it's pretty high on the grief scale. Is that relative to shows or like relative? Yeah. Was it relative
to this
like a
ending?
Real person dying?
Relative to this ending.
Okay. I feel how Michelle felt, and that's a good comparison. Like the Steven Universe future finale. I feel like that's a similar.
When he like drives off, and you're like you're happy for him to move on, but it feels so sad because like you've sat with him for so long. Yeah, it very much feels like that in a way. Like you're happy, but also it's like
this felt way less bittersweet than that one. But I definitely understand where that's coming from.
Yeah.
Okay, but how about April? Both your thoughts on the finale and what the emotional reaction was.
So my favorite part was that I loved that it aired without commercials. So props to Target for that because
wait, Target.
Props.
Yeah,
to Target.
at the very, 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 very end of it, they were just like we'd like
to
thank Target for sponsoring like commercial free experience or whatever.
It was just Saturday nights. It wasn't for Owl House specifically.
It doesn't matter.
Dylan. It was Target all along.
Listen, I will prop up Target when needed because they're great.
Exactly. No, so I really, really liked that because whenever I first watched it, I was like anticipating where they were going to put the commercials and I was really afraid because I was like, you can't just give me commercials at any moment. Like,
just like, guys, go to commercials.
There were definitely like commercial breaks though, so it's kind of weird. There were like places for the commercials.
If they didn't they anticipated that there would be commercial breaks and then like Disney's in the
because
like
also they need to like rerun it and then there'll be commercials on there.
Yeah. So and then they can expand the timeline or the length of it if they need to. So I get it. But so I really enjoyed that. There was definitely a lot going on, and I remember several times thinking, there's so much going on. We could have totally had an entire season of this, and that would have been amazing, but we did not get an entire season and no beach episode. But I absolutely loved the collector stuff because it felt very like homey, and it felt so within like the characters, for them to just like open their arms and be loving to someone who's kind of been traumatizing them for the last bit of time. And I agree with everyone that I really enjoyed how everything wrapped up, and on the my grief scale, oh goodness.
How about just the emotions from the finale? What were they?
The emotions?
It could be happy.
Oh, yeah. Oh no, I'm very happy. Like because again, like everything was wrapped up so cleanly, and I do think there's like that want of more, but also that understanding that that's just not the reality of the situation, which of course is very disheartening and sad. And I was very emotional during the both of my watch throughs, because I watched it twice today, because I love to torture myself.
Twice today, dang.
Well, because I didn't watch it like last night. I watched it after the fact. So I watched it twice today, and I definitely cried a lot, and I'm very sad. And it's definitely still in, like, the processing stage, and I don't know where I would put myself in terms of, like, the five stages of grief.
I'm in denial, personally.
Maybe a little bit of bargaining. I don't know if I'll ever hit acceptance, I'm hanging in there, so
okay, that's good.
That's what I got.
We'll try to hang in there throughout this podcast. We'll see, though. Any expressions, emotions are welcome, though. You know, we don't need to keep it bottled.
Comment below if you want to cry.
Yeah. Okay, that's a good first.
Comment below if you want to cry.
That's a good one.
All the time.
Constantly.
Yeah. When what part of the discussion made you want to cry?
How upset did we make? No.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, maybe we'll probably mostly my thoughts.
How much
people will be upset by? We'll see. Okay. I liked the finale a lot. I thought it was really good. I thought it was visually spectacular. It's kind of one of my headlines for sure.
Oh, so gorgeous.
Yeah.
What was the studio they brought in to do the special scenes? Does anybody know?
I can't remember.
Was it Sugar Cube? Or were they like...
No, it was Sugar Cube.
I think Sugar Cube's the main one. But yeah, there's also special animators as well for this episode. But yeah, I think it was great. Weirdly, I think the collector stuff was maybe my favorite plot-wise of the...
Yay!
He's just a little guy.
Yeah, I feel like they gave him his due here, and it was it was good. Definitely. The Bella stuff was like obviously great visually, but if you might expect that I was not super into it plot or lore wise, but you know, visually and excitement wise, that's its own thing too, right? And that's valid. But you know, clearly if you've been listening to the podcast, we didn't check the boxes that we're looking for. Not that the show has any obligation to or anything, but that's definitely a main reaction.
You'll
the
be time skip, from our lawyers. No.
We'll talk about it. I don't know. We'll see how much we think it affected things. The time skip epilogue. I thought it was gorgeous. The whole epilogue was so beautiful. Definitely one of my favorite parts. A little overwhelming for sure. It's so much in there.
Yes.
We'll break it down, but I did not pick up on everything the first viewing for sure.
Oh yeah, no.
Same.
I've rewatched the episode once, but I've rewatched the epilogue like five times, so I have much better handling of what's going on.
There's a lot going on in the epilogue, and it's quick.
I thought it was very much an animation finale. Like, it was more about visuals and themes than plot. There were, for some reason, a lot of shows have this. There are giant kaijus in it.
What do you mean?
I love it.
For what reason? Because they're anime.
Don't be upset about that.
It's anime, I guess. There's a big epilogue with a time skip with the narration. There was the protagonist sacrifices themselves and quote unquote dies only to meet a godlike figure. I've seen that a bunch of times as well. So I do think for me, it hit a little bit too many familiar beats, but it was great. Like what it did was great, but it definitely felt familiar. I don't know if you guys agree with that.
Yeah, I understand that. I think that's part of why I wasn't like super, I guess, like emotional when it happened, because we've experienced it a bunch of times, at least if, you know, you watch a lot of animated content, especially in recent years. There is a formula that they like to copy but make different. It's like, let me copy your homework, but like not really. But
I think it's more following
because I don't want to say it's stale because they do it differently every time, but
was definitely different. Like the Luz sacrifice was not like other sacrifices. She was not intentionally doing it, so that was nice. But it does fall into like Amphibia, Harry Potter, etc. Kind of type of thing. It did it its own way. I think rather than copying, it's more just like it's hitting established good narrative conventions, you know, like it's kind of like but especially for animation stuff. I think Kipo felt, in terms of Epilogue and Kaijus and some other stuff, felt very similar finale in a good way. I mean, I love the Kipo finale and I love this one. The Luz sacrifice stuff, I thought it was gorgeous. It didn't do too much for me personally, but we'll talk about it quickly. I mean, we can get more into this with Belos. No Belos conclusions to most of our questions.
I love it. I love that they didn't give us anything else.
We didn't really
need it. I mean, I just love that, like, oh my god.
You love that, like, Evelyn wasn't brought up, right?
No, Evelyn. Evelyn,
the claw swords might not be connected. Thank you to everything.
We were on like on the 1 yard line and he was like, we're about to confirm the claw thorns. And for some reason they just don't do it. And so Michelle does not have to believe
it. They had good sense and they held back. Thank you.
I mean, I appreciate it too. I would have liked it either way, but I think it works better this way.
So no Evelyn mention. I think this is like the most objectively, in quotes, egregious thing. Like the Belos stuff, like take it or leave it. Like that's just my opinion, right? Like I think we should have expounded upon that more. But to bring up Evelyn in the first special and then not to say her name again, I don't know why we did that. I think it was intended to maybe be an Easter egg in the end, more subtext.
Maybe it was done to like, I mean, a subversion is one theory and just to make people upset is another one.
I don't think it was to make people upset. I think again, it's that beautiful, like, leave them a little wanting.
Yeah.
No, don't answer everything.
Give us nothing, please.
Yeah. I can buy into this.
Collector lore. That was also a thing I was
That was more important for me.
That context was very helpful.
That was not more important for me, but it was for the show.
I do love that they just stomped the crap out of him.
Yes.
And he was like, I might not murder you, but my friends will. And that's good enough for me.
I love that he's like, we're better than that. We're humans. Mm-hmm. And they just come in and they're like, we're not.
Yeah, that was so good. Oh,
Is it a crime if they're goop and you just stomp on them? I don't know.
Why not?
I don't know. Or they like take over the bowling aisles and make everything fun.
I'm confused. Is that not something you should do when you find a goop monster? Just step on them.
Yeah. That's the rules, Mace. You find goop, step on it.
If I've learned anything from animated programming, it's when there's a goop monster, you step on it.
Mm-hmm. Or you wind up in an isekai.
Anyway, no, I did. We can get into more. I did not like the no Evelyn inclusion, but look, I think we should. I should have prepped for this more on our speculation podcast. Like this is like expected. Like finales are themes over plot, right? Like they don't explain if it's not explained. Right at the end, they're not going to explain it. That's okay. I just think like if they had a full season 3, I think we probably would have gotten a lot of this stuff. I think they probably intended to. And, but I do think they had time if they wanted to like expound upon Evelyn a little bit more. Like this episode was 55 minutes. So we'll talk about it more, but, I mean, obviously, I mean, if you've been listening to me on the podcast for the past 10 hours podcast, like obviously I'm not happy that there was no,
it's all been about Belos
backstory, and Evelyn and et cetera. I mean, it's all connected. Lumity. Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, I feel like at a certain point in terms of like Belos, I was like, I don't care what your backstory is anymore. Like you're the evil thing and we need to defeat you. Like, I think
that's the mindset for the, I think that's what they want you to think going into the finale. Yeah. Right. So for at least for Belos, what they were doing with him was pretty interesting. Lumity was amazing in the epilogue.
Yeah, everyone looks so cool and hot in the epilogue. I was like, no,
everyone looks very
has
awesome.
The best
LGBT
outfit I've ever seen, and the
we'll go through them very soon. I want to talk about that blog first. Actually, we'll see if I don't know. Do you guys agree that's like the top of mind thing at the end?
Probably.
You can do that.
Maybe,
yeah.
But Lumity was great. I definitely like on the lower end of what we thought we're gonna. We did get a second kiss. We did get time skip. It was great. I could have used a little bit more Lumity content, but it's, you know, it's their choice, whatever.
And the content is they've been dating for 4 years canonically, so that's something.
Yeah. Right. Well, they're very comfortable now.
And I was gonna say, I loved like at the beginning of it how like Luz is like, oh, I've just missed everyone so much, and yeah. Her mom's like, you literally saw them last week. Like,
yeah, I was watching shut that up. When it showed her packing her bags for college, I was like, what? She went back to the human realm, and it was a great subversion.
Yeah, okay, we're gonna get into that first. Last thing on my thoughts, the emotional reaction. I want to know what you guys think of this. Yeah. I felt very, and this is a commentary on expectations. I think I felt a lot more emotional about the Amphibia finale, like a lot
yeah.
more emotional. Despite the fact that I was an Amphibia casual, though, you know, like Owl House, I feel like it's because I had these big. Come on, April. You're the good one today.
Spoiling some stuff for you.
We won't spoil it. We won't spoil it. I feel like I had these big expectations for Owl House, right? And like, I think podcasting on it honestly hurts my emotional reaction to the finale in a way. I don't know. Does that make sense? Like,
yeah, because we spend a lot of time thinking about what is going to happen, and we form our own expectations that wind up being different a lot of the time from the reality.
Well, and the fact that we talk about it so much more than I say, like, the average person.
Yeah.
And it's almost like there's, like, that disconnect between us and, like, the actual watching.
Yeah, it's
experience.
About, like, casually liking something and then hyperfixating on it.
Yes.
So I think probably season 3 works better as like a casual experience. It works better as a binge, maybe. I don't know. That would be interesting.
Maybe.
But yeah,
I think, I mean, part of why it, like, I feel like feeling really emotional about Amphibia is because it's much more bittersweet than this one. This feels like it's like a real
it's just different emotions.
Happy ending. Well, not that Amphibia's ending isn't happy. It's just very. Well, it's different. I mean, for a bunch of reasons, and both of them make sense for the shows that they are.
Yeah, I think this. Well, we can transition into the ending now, talking about the epilogue. This epilogue really, I think, indulged in everything. I think that we wanted to see.
Yes,
I'm so happy we have a portal. It's the exact thing I wanted. That's like perfect. 1,000.
I love that. Just straight up bought the old shacks. They don't have to worry about that anymore.
Yeah, they bought that. Like, did we speculate that the collector would just make it?
And they did it.
Maybe there's a reason they don't keep the door open.
To make people sad.
Yes.
So here's the two-part epilogue, kind of. They're together. First of all, we get Luz narrating the aftermath of what happened. And basically everyone's reuniting, and we have a lot of great we have the headline by Lumity reuniting. I mean, they weren't apart that long.
That was not the, was that the headline? That was like kind of.
Well, they kissed yeah. again. So I think that's the headline. Yeah. But there's some other good ones. We can go through it here. Well, the first part. Oh, Ida meets Camilla and King as well.
Yes!
I cried.
Finally, we've arrived.
Yeah, we mentioned the hootie shot. I do kind of agree with the I think Cootie was like such an integral part of the show, and then starting with the season 2 finale we just forgot about him. Like, it feels
yeah weird. I mentioned that too. I was like, it's a good
and
point.
I half expected what is it, King's dad's like Hootie eye to just start like being Hootie.
Yeah, what was that?
Yeah, this can be the Hootie. So this is the Hootie origins.
Hootie
like
is
Titan.
Hootie
so,
is King's dad.
Okay, well, which of these do you guys?
No.
Which of these do you guys Hootie think is true? One, Hootie was a Titan's eye. That's what he is. He's a Titan eye. Two,
what?
Two, Hootie is like a parasite that leeches onto Titans.
Oh,
I like that one. That's more accurate. That's probably more
that
accurate.
One, you, that one feels more correct.
Maybe Hootie's got Titan's brain poking out from his eye hole. Maybe that's it.
Or do you guys have another explanation based on that Hootie-esque?
No, I don't know what Hootie was doing there. Like, what was that?
I think that was a different Hootie, right?
I think it was just there.
I guess it could have been our Hootie because King's dad exists in between and the skeleton, so maybe it could have actually been.
I
like,
think Hootie lived with King's dad and he like forgot or something.
Yeah,
so there's only one Hootie.
My interpretation.
That was how he like ensured his son was like taken care of.
Oh yeah,
because he mentioned that. Was
like, oh god, it's
he's like I'm gonna put this
worst nanny.
You know yeah. me, and I know you, but I'm gonna erase your memory so you don't know, and then you just take care of my. I don't know.
I'm gonna That's definitely how we talk parasite. That's canon now.
Yeah, no, when I watched it, I was like, oh, hooties are titan eyes. That's what they are.
Hooties? There's multiple are titan eyes.
Yeah, like
when
hootie
King gets
species.
Bigger, he'll grow his own hooties out of his eyes.
Well, no, think about it, because the titans are dead, right? So that's why there used to be a lot more hooties when there are a bunch more titans.
Oh, my God. Yeah, he's
so
last
this
of
why,
time.
This is actually why the archivists got rid of them, because the hooties made them too powerful.
Were they too terrifying?
Okay. Yeah, that's the first thing the archives were like, oh, they got hooties, they gotta go.
That's understandable, though, honestly. So we maybe
they're
we
like,
can...
those monstrous creatures right there.
I like the interpretation. I'm going to steal Alex's because we watched together yeah. and you mentioned this before, that like his interpretation is that he, or King's dad rather, like was watching everyone and like incorporated something from each of the people that were important to King, because he had Ida's shirt on. Mm-hmm. He had glyph pants, mm-hmm. but, and I don't know, I guess the glyphs were for Luz, and then Hootie, the eyeball.
Hootie's just in his eye.
Yeah, well, was Hootie in the screen that he saw?
Well, he's also yeah. casual. He's just
what about the one that he saw?
Yeah, that's just him relaxing.
I need to go back.
That's his thing for him, not for anyone else.
Yeah,
we saw like a vision of what he was observing the whole time. Was Hootie in that vision? Like,
oh yeah, he was.
Been
no.
The, was Hootie
no.
the eyes that recorded what we saw, right? I don't know. I got to
Oh, yeah. Oh.
So the interesting
space is just Hootie. Because we didn't really get an explanation on the in-between space either. I'm assuming it's just like the Titan, because that's like how the world works.
He named it the in-between, and it's like between all of the realms, I guess.
Well, and we've seen yeah. it before, so.
Multiple times. It's just, yeah. it's hard to explain that in a finale.
This was the quote-unquote explanation. Anyway, I like that Hootie is the king's dad's eye. Like, I'm on that.
I like him being a parasite.
He's the essence.
And, he could be
your
both.
Father now. It's like a worm and an apple, but the apple is his whole head.
Okay, that was your Hootie discussion. If anyone has further thoughts as we go, jump
everyone
in,
clicked
let's...
off now. They've been
yeah.
okay.
Like
no, they clicked on. They were waiting for this part.
That was just for you guys for sticking with the Owl House podcast, because I know that's what
there
you were trying
go.
To find
that's
in
why
the show.
That's
no, you were trying to fast forward to the Hootie discussion. There it was. Okay. Part two, 18-year-old Luz, not explicitly said, but right implied, has graduated from high school on Earth. While having a portal available to visit the Boiling Isles in the meantime, she also like yeah. helped rebuild for several years. So I guess she's going back and forth between rebuilding.
I'm just like,
Boiling
why even go to regular high school at that point? If you're, especially if you're going to college in the Demon Realm, I don't understand.
On a Disney Channel show, you cannot say that you just drop out of high school.
Yeah.
You can't
come
do
on,
it.
Yeah. people drop out of high school.
I just assumed she could go back to the Boiling Isle school to Hexside.
I like to think that it was like a. Like an agreement she struck with her mom kind
yeah.
of thing, you know, yeah. like.
I also think it's
you
healthier
need human
probably
skills.
To,
yeah. Just at least get your high school diploma and then.
You gotta go balance a checkbook. They don't teach you that in high school.
They don't teach you that in yeah. high school.
God.
Yeah. So, yeah. So
but she had a creative writing certificate.
Scholarship. Yeah. yeah. That was cool.
It was signed by Dana Tarrant.
Yeah, I noticed that. I was yeah. like, what does this imply?
A lot
also,
of background.
Canon of this universe.
Also, I feel like that's almost cheating because she could just literally write about her adventures yeah. in the Boiling Isles. And everyone would be like, you're so creative.
Yeah, like, wow.
I will have
this?
To say, and we're going to talk about everyone's designs, but she's just so gender.
Yes!
She looks so good.
Oh my god.
Michelle, it reminded
so
me
gender.
Of you because she has the short hair and the like.
If I can, I mean, I'm old, so if I dress, I'd be lucky if I dressed that cool when I was 18. That's what I'll say. I did not have that fashion sense.
Yeah.
Remind me of the Kipo time skip a little bit.
Yes!
Yeah,
yes.
Oh my god, Kipo looks so good. Oh my god.
Yeah. Same thing.
Everyone's clothes were so hot. I just can't believe Ida's like a Captain Hook. Like headmaster, like what? That's so great.
I love that she had a hook for her.
Love the hook.
I did.
Yes.
Practical. What are you going to do with that?
So
yeah,
much.
Wink and you can open soda cans.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, we can keep going through people's
goop
looks, yeah.
people.
Luz also has the scar in her eye still. She is.
And she's wearing
Amity's necklace.
Mascara. Yes.
Huh.
Jewelry exchanging in this too is pretty. It seems
it.
Like a gay thing.
It's like another earring.
Nice day.
I believe they have tattoos somewhere as well.
Yeah, they have. They all have tattoos.
Do they all have flapjack
tattoos? Yes.
Hunter and Willow definitely have flapjack.
So close. I like slowed down the frames. I was like, "Is that a flapjack tattoo?"
It is. Luz has one on her left arm. Amity has one on her right, or it's the opposite. Hunter has one on his right wrist. Willow has one on her left shoulder. I don't know where Gus has one, but he definitely does.
He's a jackal.
He has to have one.
Awesome.
I'm about to get one. I'm putting it on the list of.
Are they like red, Allie? Is that?
It's the red one.
Yeah. Okay. I see a couple of them.
If you scroll on that line, yeah. There's Willow and Hunter for sure. They're very.
If you go on Twitter, everyone's been talking about.
Yes.
Yeah, but Luz. I think Luz is probably. I mean, Amity as well. Great.
Oh, and she has her beta shirt. Skip. I just realized.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, she does have the beta shirt from the pilot. Yeah. Oh, that's a nice callback.
Aww.
Amity has
gay
undercut.
She looks so gay.
Amity has a gay.
Allie, my first reaction when I saw Amity was like, "It's a V from Arcane." I feel like she has a very V.
Bye.
Just there's V in the just show. Bye. Undercut, steampunk kind of look.
I miss lesbian, so I mean, it works. It's the same.
I miss my undercut.
I want to get. They were too late to have a new one. New hair.
She's like, you could tell how much she like really loves and is inspired by her dad because she did the same thing like with Abomination Engineering. And she's like a little mechanic lesbian. She's so cute.
Can we talk about that moment with like Luz is narrating? She's like, and everyone like gotta go hug their loved ones. And Amity goes their dad, and then they just pan and Dolly's just sitting in the corner, corner like
chilling.
Like, are they divorced? Who freaking knows? A hilarious
after the
moment.
Epilogue. Someone commented. They were like, I bet she's in a nursing home now.
She's in the first epilogue.
She's
not
only
the 18. Lady.
Why would she be in a nursing
home? No, the mom.
Why would Odalia be in a nursing home?
Because no one likes her.
Could be in prison.
Does she aged prematurely? Is that what that means?
One wants to deal with her. Like,
oh, she's not in the picture.
Divorce,
clearly,
so it's just crazy. Yeah.
Yeah. In the second epilogue, she's nowhere to be found.
Yeah. Odalia not in the time skip. Anyway, Ida is headmaster of the college. As the way there's the hook,
we gotta go through everybody.
Willow got so hot by the way. That short haircut,
she is
really working. Yeah, she kept picking up Hunter, and I was like, this is the hottest thing in the entire world.
So she's theoretically
she's got
the captain.
Like muscle definition.
Yeah, she's strong.
She's the captain of the like hypothetical, I guess, college Emerald Entrails team.
Oh, yeah.
And then Hunter is Palace McCarvey.
I know. I love that for him. That makes much sense.
The best possible outcome.
Hunter has a new Blue Jay Palisman, apparently named Waffle. Yeah.
Waffle!
Which is not in the episode, by the way. You didn't miss that. But yeah, Waffle.
Perfect.
And studying under Dell, probably, seems like.
Yeah.
Which makes, you know, sense since.
New daddy.
Since Clawthorns are, Caleb was dated the Clawthorn.
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The connection, this is, again, further, they continue to hint at it and out-confirming it.
We'll never know. Christmas came early for me.
Can you believe that they just.
We did it. We've arrived.
I'm fine with not like explaining that. It's just like no mention of her.
Yeah.
I feel like Flapjack just definitely belonged to Evelyn, and that was the whole thing, probably.
Mm-hmm.
That's my thought.
I guess so.
Because that's how,
Maybe we'll find out in that spinoff series. Who knows?
If there's a spinoff, the one thing I was kind of like, I just wanted Gus to have a little something.
Yep, not a lot of Gus here for sure.
He's the president of the human club, but I thought he would have done more stuff with like Illumination. What is it? Not Illumination.
Illusions?
Thank you.
Yeah, older Gus looks very different. He does have the illusion, I think, thing on his ear. But yeah, he has glasses.
His hair rocks, like his whole young adult.
Yes,
God. Is very good.
Great new design.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
everyone looks so good.
Does Rain look much different?
They have more hair now.
Oh, they do have more hair.
Someone said, again, I'm on Twitter too much for my own like mental health well-being, but someone was like, they should have Belos like possess everyone with receding hairlines, but I can't remember who else had a receding hairline that he possessed.
Question, does Rain have like scars on their face from the possession?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Wow.
Mm,
They look real good.
Which I love.
They do look kind of cool, unfortunate. But yeah.
Listen, scars are attractive. I'm sorry.
I mean, Luz definitely, like, you know, keep that. Now she looks like a cool pirate. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. She's got so many scars.
Poor guy. Okay, Luz, your fave look of the older looks?
Oh, Jesus.
Just, she's so gender, and I want to look that way.
I love Ida just because it's a bold choice to be Captain Hook and a school president. But, like, hell yeah, if anyone could pull that off, that it's her.
Oh, I'm here for
Oh, wait, what about King? I mean, not that anyone would want to look like him, I guess, because he's a real animal.
He's a little older.
He looked a little bigger.
Yeah. Like, not as big as we thought.
Changed about him where he had longer limbs, a longer tail, and longer horns one got chopped off.
I was expecting his voice to be deeper or something. I know. He was a teenager, but not yet. Just
sound like he's Alex still Bush. Baby.
Yeah. Hello, Luz.
Hey,
Luz. I want to sound like Grunkle Stan when he's, like, old.
Is that what King's gonna sound like eventually?
I hope so. I want
that. We can only pray.
Do you want that? April, which was your favorite?
Who were your guys' favorites?
Oh, Amity.
Yes.
Because she kind of has, like, a pirate thing going on, too. Yeah.
She sure does.
And I love, like, the crystals in her ponytail.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm here for that.
Yeah, there's a picture on Luz's bulletin board of Amity younger with the undercut, so I guess it happened at some point.
Oh, yeah, the updated Grom picture.
I'm scrolling through to see if I can find that.
Yeah, I have that somewhere. I think, I love Amity's. I think Luz is impressively looks, like, normal, because I think when you age up characters a lot, they look just like a, like, weird, lanky version of the younger design. I was impressed with Luz for sure. At least,
I was almost expecting her to have the big, like, fluffy hair that she had whenever she had King's dad's power. I was waiting for it. Maybe
I
in like a big
Amity
poopy
to see her that way.
Oh, me too.
Yeah, Amity never got the saw. Yeah. At first I thought that's just what Luz was gonna look like now.
Yeah, forever.
Yes, that's what I thought too. I was excited. Space buns. Oh, so cute.
And I wanted her to keep the snaggle tooth. The fang.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no, the fang was nice.
Because it looks like Ida's fang.
Oh, no.
So Luz is going to attend the new University of Wild Magic that Ida's the headmaster of, right? And everyone in the Boiling Isles throw her surprise makeup King Sinera.
King
Sinera.
So cute. I love this because we had been speculating, like, it's got to be a wedding, right? Something's going to bring them all together, but none of us called a quinceañera.
I think we mentioned a quinceañera at some point.
Did we? Okay. Well,
at some point, I feel like. I said a high school graduation. I guess this is a similar, you know.
Kind of both, maybe. Kind of
Yeah, because, I mean, they're throwing a party for her no matter what. But I like the quinceañera. Like.
Yeah, no, that's so good.
Yeah, other highlights of the time skip. So we talked about Waffle, Flapjack's grave.
I cried.
We have
Darius adopting Hunter.
Yeah, yes. Darius adopting Hunter and Alador and Darius' new ship.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yo, it's that was canon. Unexpected, but, like, hello.
I love it.
Were people shipping this? They're shipping Darius.
Yes, absolutely. We were shipping it, but we're just like, there's no way.
If two characters exist, they can be shipped together.
Especially if they stand next to each other. That's all.
Have, like, a rival.
That's all it takes.
Yeah.
And
so
also, speaking of ships, Willow's dad's kissed. No one's talking about that.
That was very nice.
Okay. And the Lumity scenes in the first, the pre-time skip, we had them kissing when they're reuniting.
Yes.
And then post-time skip, when Luz comes through the portal, Amity kisses her on the cheek.
Big old kiss.
Yeah. That was really nice. Yeah. That scene. And then when they're saying goodbye to the Cleptor, like holding hands and stuff.
Yeah.
So that's nice. What about was there any other Lumity that we were wanting, thinking, as are we I mean, definitely I will say I think I would this is such a, like, fanfic ending with they're in college now. Like, this is the spinoff show we want. I know they mentioned the other potential spinoff earlier.
I love that.
Did you know Lilith was Ida's captain? Oh, really? Yeah. Now that's a spinoff I'd watch.
That spin-off.
Which Dana's mentioned would be the spinoff. So that's like the real spinoff pitch.
Oh, that would be so amazing.
But I don't want that. I want this. I want them in college. That would be good too. But
look, we all want that. But let's be reasonable.
we can put a twist on it. Lilith will be the coach of the new Emerald Entrails team.
And then we flash back sometimes to the
exactly.
Yeah. It's like days. That would be really good.
A reminder.
If Lilith was leading it, that would be great because that would like guarantee more Hootie all the time because Hootie hangs out with her constantly.
Oh, yeah. I forgot Lilith's new look, very mother.
Yeah.
And we got her heartbeat form finally.
She seems to really dig it.
She looks good.
Yeah, there's a bunch of other forms too. I just put the ones at the end, but where's Lilith in this picture? Oh, I guess she's behind them. Okay. And Hootie's there sticking out too at the end. Hootie's in the backpack. So, okay, this isn't important, but is Hootie the owl house? Where's the owl house? Are they at the owl house at the end?
They're in a treehouse thing.
So they were
Wait, were they?
Okay.
Yeah.
So they're in the college, and that's in a forest, and I think that's probably close to the owl house. And then
it looks like it was
scenes.
The same place.
It might be the exact same place. The problem is they never pan out. Like, I don't know what's happening.
But it looks like Luz, like, when she comes in from the portal with Camila and V, it looks like they're, like, at the front door of the owl house.
The portal door is the new door of the owl house. Is that what's happening?
Oh, maybe. It seems like it might be, like, interchangeable.
And Hootie is like, yeah, maybe they can switch, but Hootie's, like, in the
because
backpack,
that's how
so we don't know if Hootie's still in
the door. Worked.
Yeah,
like if it wasn't the portal door, it was just an abandoned
I guess
house.
It Cootie could go back in when it's not. But it could just be I'm not sure if it's a permanent portal door, because obviously the collector set them up with this new portal thing.
I love that is like the perfect way to do it, too. I'm very happy about that.
Yeah. We probably should have just said that the collector would do it. He can instantly snap their fingers.
Which is perfect, because that's the easiest solution.
Yes. Would be more interesting, but more complicated to explain.
Yeah, but does anyone have a better explanation for like what's going on with the owl house? Like, this
like,
is the one
is
thing I didn't really understand from the epilogue. I think they're at.
Maybe
I think
it's like
their
summer vacation home or something. I don't know.
I don't know. I'm
I
like
think
going
mine
through,
makes sense.
And I can't. I don't.
It's so they're just zoomed in the whole time. Yeah, Allie, you thought they were at the owl house at the end.
Well, because it makes sense because of the way the human portal used to work. Like, if it was just active, then it was the real portal. And if it was, like, powered down, it was, like, a random house with nothing in it. So, theoretically, it would be the owl house, like, normally, unless the portal is activated. Problem is, how does it get activated?
Maybe they just, like, set it up on the side of the house or something like that.
So I'm trying to... I have to find the episode now. Because, like, when King is drawing the sigil, I feel like Luz is like on the porch, or like you could see King at the front of everything trying to get everything set.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. I think once we switch the scene to Luz coming through the portal, I think they're at the owl house, and before that, they're at the college. I'm just not sure where the college is.
I'm
watching it right now.
Where is the college?
The college is in the woods in the middle
in
of the Titan, stomach, chest, cavity.
Okay,
lungs.
No, yeah, the door.
And the door's to the front of the owl house.
Oh, I didn't realize this. Yeah,
who's hanging out?
Okay, so maybe
Hootie is
right. The door is the door
totally
of the house, right?
I feel like King probably just gave himself a little cut through some time blood on the main door of the owl house, and it was good to go to be a portal.
I think the collector just did it. I think the collector.
Oh, the collector did it.
Their finger.
Yeah.
Well, so then when the door opens, it says the collector says like welcome to the.
Oh right. Okay. So it's
the collector like recorded themselves. Yeah.
Was it the door originally like portable? So maybe door is portable as well. So they can take it wherever they want to.
But where do they live? If this is like...
Right, yeah.
Oh, no, no.
Maybe they all live at the college. I mean, Lilith probably doesn't live there, but I don't know.
They do like really trash the house.
That's confusing to me.
Yeah,
Lilith is renovating Hexside, so Lilith might be separate from them. Anyway, okay, we can come back to Lumity for a second because I'm intertwining these discussions. I think the main thing that I would have wanted to see, this is a shortened season 3, so we have less time. Obviously, that's an explanation for all of this. I would have liked to have seen them, Luz and Amy, discussing, we talked about this, discussing what their future would have been like. Instead, we just see the reality of it's implied that they saw each other. We see in some photographs in the background on Luz's bulletin board. I think one of them I think Amity and Hootie are in the human realm. And then another one there back at Grom. So clearly they saw each other throughout when Luz was in high school. But yeah, I guess we're just left with them referencing it before they walked through the portal door in the first special, which was good.
Yeah.
But yeah, where do they go from there?
Are they both more time? They would have done like an actual conversation.
Yes.
Probably.
Like, where do we go from here?
What do we think there? Is Amity attending the college?
It seems like they all, well, maybe not, actually. I don't know.
It's really hard to tell what's going on.
Because it seems like she's taking over what her dad's doing, so she might not even. Well, maybe that's she like probably need to go to college, but not.
Maybe she does college part-time.
Yeah. But like, regardless, Luz is going to live in the Boiling Isles now to attend college. It's very funny that there's like an acceptance letter and like here's your
move. Yeah,
like, didn't Ida just make all of this? Like, why does this need to be so official with
she's not the only attendee. Everyone else
Luz is special though. Yeah. Gus is a teacher there.
How does her scholarship work?
Dorms. Well, she definitely deserves a scholarship because she just saved the world.
Well, yeah, but I was curious.
The treetops for the school.
This is why this is such a fanfic ending. All of this is going to be extrapolated upon in many fanfics.
Yes. Yes.
So this is a
Owl House future when?
Oh, no.
Honestly, it's a great setup for Owl House Future.
It really is a great setup for Owl House Future.
Hey, Disney, remember when you like didn't realize that the show is popular online?
I know, now you can getting millions of views. It. Wow.
Now, greenlight a Disney Plus only more adult show about them in college. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do it, Disney.
You know how much money you could make?
So much.
Just like actually make merchandise for the show this time. And you'll make so much money.
Oh, yes.
What else from the epilogues? Yeah. What else? What other epilogue things haven't we talked about enough?
Maddie has an S tattoo. The stupid high school S. He has one on his arm.
Oh my god! This is not gonna die. This is the next 20 years in children's animation is finding S's everywhere.
The S never dies.
It never goes. Zoomers anywhere. Are like what? But everyone else, we know.
We're aware.
Yes, actually,
Zoomers probably know too. At this point, everyone knows.
Oh, Zoomers know.
They're just like why?
Any other Zoomers know all? They scare me. Because there's a lot of people there. At the Basha got to reunite with her team, stuff like that.
And Skara is like a bard, seemingly teacher.
Yeah.
Apparently, also a lot of crew got like more like character cameos. I know Rebecca Rose. She pointed hers out, and it's like her profile picture now. It's very cute.
That was very cute.
Aww. What else happened in the epilogue?
I mean, it's
Kikimora is doing hard labor for the rest of her life.
Where's that?
She's helping rebuild Hexside, but she's like doing like the lifting. And then she was not at the party, which was amazing.
Not invited to the party. Also surprised she's allowed to live.
Yeah. Listen, the only one who's not allowed to live is Belos.
We don't know about Adalia. It's never gonna be okay.
Not sure about Adalia, just saying.
She's in the nursing home.
We're not worried about her.
Given the death penalty.
Like Isles probably.
Luz's first act as new emperor.
She's living in the woods.
Adalia gets the death
penalty. She's not the new emperor.
Who's the emperor? What's the political system?
There's no emperor.
They're getting rid of the coven sigils for a reason. It's a demise.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So they're getting rid of the coven sigils.
That's so useful. I do like that.
Viney and M doing it. Stands. Mm-hmm. What's that ship name? I don't know, but it's a good ship.
Reference to the coven heads being kept in check, the non-good ones.
And they were excited to have the sigils removed. I loved it.
Those coven heads, one of them was like a weirdo. I don't know who he was.
Oh, yeah. The creepy one.
Yeah.
Okay. Any last thoughts on the epilogues? We have
it's perfect.
Feel very good about the epilogue.
Me too. We didn't mention the collector leaving to go back to the stars, but I feel like we talked about that on the speculation.
Happened. Yeah. I just couldn't see the collector staying because they're so young and they have so much to figure out about.
They have to learn a lot.
Which is literally what they said in the show.
Yeah.
Very good. But I love that King gave him Francois. They're friends. It wound up being perfect. They wound up being friends. Mm-hmm. They broke the cycle of violence. That was not even really a cycle. It was just.
It wasn't even a cycle.
I just saw a comment on Twitter that Hunter's eye bags are gone now.
Oh yeah,
he's like, yay! Yeah.
He's well rested.
That's a really good thing to point out.
Getting sleep.
Nice, finally nice. Getting sleep.
Wait, Michelle, you didn't talk about Huntlow at all.
I mean, I did. I was like,
you're like the original Stan.
I love that Willow like kept grabbing him and picking him up and showing how buff she was. That was so hot. I'm so happy. I mean, I do like there was a version of either the finale or the epilogue where I thought like maybe like Luz and Anderer are gonna have like a very special moment. They've been having those special moments the whole show. I think it's really fine that like romance wasn't the heart of this
film. Yeah, I definitely
like, agree. For this show, for that not to be necessarily the biggest priority. And they left in a really good place. They have so much left to do with each other. All these couples have so, you know what I mean?
With each other.
Yes. Life's ahead of them and they're together and I know that and that's all I need to know. Like it's gonna be great. But no, how yeah. God, yes. I mean, if Hollow had smooched, oh, but like again, maybe a spin-off could happen and they can make out for a whole episode. So
that's also how I feel about Rita. Like at first, yeah. For both of them, I was like, where's the smooches? Where's the smooching? But it feels good. They're like both in good places. And also someone pointed out they exchanged jewelry too. Like Ida mm-hmm. has Rain's necklace and Rain has Ida's necklace, not necklace, earrings.
That's perfect.
Nice.
It's how you know they date and kissing all the time.
Yeah.
Also, Huntlow definitely kissed in the 4 years, you know.
Yes. Oh my God. Yes.
Yeah. It was off screen. Yeah. Okay, but we're talking about the collector. Let's talk about all the collector stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. I was impressed with the level of detail we delved into with the collector. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really wasn't that much.
I wasn't surprised, but it was very satisfying. Like having Luz be the one to like, I mean, I agree. I think I forgot if Michelle or April said this, but I also kind of expected King to be the one to like,
talk
to him, but
it definitely makes more sense for Luz to be sort of like the one who reaches out.
Well, and she's like the main character. So mm-hmm. I think that's why like,
and she's the empathic queen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like she was the person who could almost relate to them the most, like, I mean, not the most, but you know, as the
but
main
like who
character.
Could like get on their level to be like, was going through a lot and then I found people and I connected with them and didn't force them to like me.
And I think that's what like, I don't know, I guess he needed, because he just assumed that like the friendships happened like instantly or they were forced. And she's like, well, no, like we had to go through all of this to get as close as we are. So like,
how you guys feel about the archivist backstory?
Yeah, well, okay. Yeah, before that, Luz also teaches the collector, people are complex and need a little kindness and forgiveness, which the collector then tries to apply to.
That was funny.
Oh, poor
giant Belos. Kaiju Belos.
That was so funny. I was like,
was that a Steven Universe jam?
No.
that was. So, that was the first thing I thought of was like, this is like the Change Your Mind Steven Universe name.
That's pretty funny.
I really love that scene of the collector trying to talk to the Belos. It was like it felt like the Cliff Notes version of that. Like a full season, I would have loved like a fuller plotline of that. You know?
It was also just very adorable because he's like, oh, I'm gonna apply what I just learned to this completely unhinged situation that I have no clue what's going on.
Like I was told one thing, I'll just straight up do it. That makes sense. Which. Collector is so easy to just like believe people, so that like checks out. They would just try it.
He's a little dude. He's very naive.
He's a little kid.
He doesn't know his ABCs. He's learning.
He doesn't know how death works.
Seriously.
My gosh.
Because he knows now, but he didn't go in knowing.
I think that was what made like Luz's dying scene.
Yeah.
Like the hardest for me was because the collector like didn't understand what just took place. And I was like, oh no, I know what's going on.
Through, like grieving, like for the first time, he was like, what is this? Tears? What does this mean? Why does my heart hurt?
He rushes to like brush the Belos off of Ida, like get off of her.
Precious bean.
Yeah, and I agree with all that. And then we mentioned we get the backstory with the archivists and the Titans a little bit, like a little expanded upon version of the things from the archive, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and you know,
I think it fit. Like, it definitely made the Collector as a sympathetic character that you kind of needed in order for. Like, loses lesson to hit home for him. Like, he was just doing what he was told, and he went down, and he made friends with Titans, and then the archivists were like, yeah, we're gonna take your friends away.
I think it works that they gave a backstory, and not that I expected them not to, because you kind of have to at that point. Well, but I want to know why they were such meanies. For no reason.
I wonder if it's just because he's the kid, and they're just big bullies.
Yeah, but I think you combine it with the stuff from the book last episode, and it's like this is their it's in their rules, it's their purpose to archive and then destroy them if they don't cooperate. So those were like the archivists, and he, you know, but he's younger and he's the Collector's not necessarily following everything there.
He hasn't graduated yet.
Yeah, so he was playing with the Titan. They were playing with the Titan babies, and the archivist took the Titans away. And then we learned that King's dad
came back, and they were all
incorrectly
gone.
Trapped the Collector. Yeah,
Which but also I like that it helps explain why he latched on to King, initially, because he was like, oh, it's a baby Titan, this is a friend. Kind of situation.
Yeah, because they were playing with all the baby Titans before too. Yeah,
It's a kitty.
You mean the dog?
the dog. Yeah.
Everyone thinks he's a dog.
Yeah, Michelle, what do you think of the Collector backstory?
I liked it. I feel like it was the perfect amount of context without needing to get into too much more. Like it sets up, okay, he's the youngest, those are his siblings, he isn't as old, so therefore isn't as clued into, I guess, because I can imagine, if you're that powerful, I can understand getting kind of jaded and just, nothing is as powerful as us, and that's how it should be. He's young enough to kind of question that and to think about things a different way. Plus, he doesn't seem to like his siblings. They don't seem like they're on great terms, so doing the opposite approach kind of makes sense. And I feel like it definitely endeared me to the Collector a little more, because he never really had bad intentions. Not to say he didn't cause a lot of havoc, it can be scary, but clearly he never really wanted to hurt the Titans, and that I feel like helped.
I think
I
was gonna say it also makes it clues you in as to why he doesn't understand the concept of humanity, because Titans live forever, and collectors and archivists also live forever. And so the fact that he was just I can just fix things, if they're not, an immortal being more or less. So that makes sense why he didn't understand the concept of death, because he's probably never experienced it besides the archivist just taking. I mean, he said, if I remember correctly, he said they just took away all the rest of the Titans.
Mm-hmm. Disappeared one by one.
Yeah, they didn't die or anything. So he's never been exposed to real death before, because even King's dad was kind of alive in a sense.
Yeah, that's, oh my god, the crazy thing is that the Titan was alive this whole time.
Well, I guess that's
the craziest reveal.
I've been wondering about that Dingheart since season one. I was like, who is this? What is this? And they never and talked about know. It. Now we know. Yeah. I love that came back.
Well, we should have thought of the Heartmaw for sure when we were speculating.
That he's been alive this whole time.
Also, why didn't Belos try and do that from the beginning?
Yeah, exactly.
He's dumb, not. Dumb. He wasn't goop form now.
I think no. It's because when he was talking to the collector's like, oh well, I can't hurt King.
He didn't know King was a Titan.
And so he was like, it's not that he didn't know King was a Titan. He's like, oh, I didn't know collectors couldn't hurt Titans. So if I just become a Titan, Collector can't get me. I think it was really just that. He's like, okay, cool. I know the hardest. Better kill her.
Collector gave him a lot of info.
Because it's true. Yeah. He did not know that information.
Yeah, he didn't know that.
Yeah. To wrap up the collector, I agree. It was like a little bit of a bare bones backstory, but that's what we needed, right? Because this wasn't something we're super connected to in depth with the lore. It felt like the right amount. It was a great wrap up of this part of the story. So I really liked all that. You know, on the other hand, let's talk about the Belos stuff more. Belos taking over the Titan Heart. Belos becomes a kaiju on their
finale. On their bingo card. None of us.
I should have mentioned it. It really happens all the time.
Every time this happens, I'm like, this is so silly. It's just not my thing. But it happens. I don't know. It happens for a reason. I guess.
It's a formula in so many stories.
Makes it bad. It just makes me think about anime a lot, and I don't know if that's
what's
the point.
Wrong with Maybe. Anime. No.
I'm not saying that's wrong. It's just Belos has been so silly looking for so long, and so many goofy monster forms. This is just the culmination. This is the culmination of crazy designs we could give him.
And the even crazier part is that he's like reforming the Titan, but then he also has like this kaiju form on top of the body kind of that both. He's reforming.
The fact that he was controlling it. Do you guys remember that there was like a fake leak of like a Titan's body standing up? Back in the day, I thought he was gonna do that, but then instead he wound up just having the fruity hand gesture at the end.
Just
fruity hand gesture.
Just reaching up to the stars.
My guess on why why Korra, Kipo, Owlhouse, why they have kaiju stuff in finale. My guess is like the biggest visual spectacle animation, such a visual like focused medium. Yeah. I think that's probably you just go the biggest you can in the biggest episode.
The problem has to be larger than the characters, not only in strength, but also physically. Yeah. So, which is why, the collector was so interesting whenever they were first introduced, because they were so tiny and so powerful.
Oh, that's true. Mm-hmm. It contrasts with the tininess of the collector. I like that.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah. He gave me kaiju. I didn't expect him to also fire my lasers. And he's infecting all of the Boiling Isles.
I didn't expect the Last of Us reference in
there. Immediately I was like, this is the fungal infection from the Last of Us. It looks so much like it.
It's a real thing. It could happen.
It could happen.
It could happen
to you.
People were just becoming the infected.
To you. It could happen to the Boiling Isles. We should be afraid. Yeah.
This is definitely storyboarded before the Last of Us show, but it's like funny that.
The Last of Us game.
I know they might have referenced that from a while ago. I don't know.
I mean, honestly, just fungi in general. It's like it's really gross looking.
Yeah.
And
also,
creepy.
Last of Us didn't, invent that. Yeah, that's true. But maybe I wonder if that was an inspiration or if it's just top of mind.
They were just like, we really all, the whole team loved this show. Let's make his infection like.
And we're going to have
a problem. I guess it's like the natural conclusion of Goop Belos, like spreading everywhere.
Exactly. Yeah.
His goop's getting all over the town. Spreading that goop.
All this is very visual, right? Not a plot driven stuff. That's kind of why I was saying that in the beginning. Kaiju Belos affecting
everything.
But
it's lore driven, kind of, because he's connected to the heart and
he's
whole
reforming the Titan body. So
also, we saw them when they go when Luz is in her magic form, which we have to talk about. When they the way up in the air, we saw different Titan bodies. So the whole world is just islands.
You could zoom into that screenshot. I think there's maybe real land masses too, and then Titans on top of them. I'm not sure. That was kind of what I saw there. Very funny. They go into space, another kind of big anime type of thing.
The collector leaves to go to the stars.
Absolutely. Anime is just Japanese animation, y'all. It's still animation.
It's true.
This is a Japanese animation show, clearly.
Yeah, have a dub.
I was surprised that the Demon Realm was a planet. I like that.
I've been wondering how that works, because we never saw such a pullout before.
I wonder if that was really thought out or if it's just for the visual moment. I bet that there's not a big plan, but maybe I'm wrong with that. Because it's another realm isn't necessarily another planet, you know?
What else?
Another dimension.
Speck in space. Or maybe space isn't even a thing. It's a different universe.
Yeah. Parallel universe.
Spooky.
don't know how
in terms of the Titan, we also see the when we're in the in between, we see the when King's dad is dying, we see the giant Titan skeleton
in the middle of him,
like go down.
Yeah, that's like it, how I don't know. I thought it was like him transitioning to his real form.
Yeah,
I think it's almost like he chose like a fun form. And then he was like, oh well, since I'm actually dying, I'm gonna take my real form.
Is he a non-binary king? Because he did the king and queen best of both things.
That was nice.
Gender fluid king.
Well,
yeah. Should we move to that? So yeah, so Luz meets King's dad in the. It's all connected. This part.
Yes.
Luz meets King's dad in the in between with the hoodie eye, which we talked about. King's dad says King explained it best. Both king and queen, but dad works fine. Definitely gives like a non-binary gender queer type of explanation. Like the implication being you can call him King's dad, but maybe that's not even like the it's probably not a male gendered, which means what my thought was, are all Titans non-gendered?
Yes.
Do Titans not like sexually reproduce? Do they just reproduce on their own? So maybe King could have more children.
Or like
on
the frogs that change their gender depending upon their environment.
Like Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
Be like gender fluid, could be no gender,
like,
any regardless.
There's like actual frogs that will change their sex. That's so cool. Too many females, like Jurassic Park, then some of them will turn into males.
Oh my god.
So that they can reproduce.
I want to be a frog. Just able to change gender at will. What?
Frogs make it look so easy.
That's cool.
I think there's like fish that do that too. So
I will be an amphibious creature.
Amphibia. So yeah, that I really like that with the gender stuff with King's dad for sure. That was a great build.
Aaron Hansen, you did a great performance. So unexpected.
As King's dad, yeah. What else from King's dad? They talk about Belos doesn't care about anything.
Well, so I need to go back. To me, it's crazy that he was alive the whole time and just unconscious in the in between, and then like saw Luz. Obviously, like being nice to his son, and was like, you know, I trust you with my language. Like, no, that I don't trust anybody else but you.
Yeah. Oh, is that your interpretation that King's dad only gave it to Luz?
Yeah, because I mean, he, like, even the collector was like, he never showed me. He didn't trust me that way. And like, I mean, I guess no one else would really need it because everyone else has like real magic.
So maybe he revealed it to her the first glyph. But other people can use glyphs after that, right?
That's true.
I was gonna say but.
That was kind of trying, like, and he got like messed up.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It just
could have had some magical connection. Yeah, I like that.
And then their whole conversation was just beautiful. Like
King's dad, they give the power to Luz, the last bit of life, all the glyphs, which I think I thought were really visually cool. I think this is a great conclusion to the in between, which we've been seeing, even though it wasn't explained a lot. I don't think that's the type of thing you explain a ton.
I don't think it needed to be explained. No.
It's not necessary.
Because
King's dad, I thought it was a great conclusion to King's dad and stuff too.
Yeah.
So look, I think we concluded stuff well.
It was a really good conclusion to like Luz's worries about being as bad as her enemies, because like she thought her motives were coming from the same place, and he basically confirmed that no, that's not the case.
Well, in her, her guilt about starting the Belos situation.
Yeah,
and he was like, "No, you're a genuine person. This guy is a faker." Mm-hmm.
I loved that explanation, how he wants so desperately to be the hero in his own delusion.
Yes.
And I was like, that is such a beautiful sentence. Like,
explains all the Grimwalkers. Mm-hmm. You gotta be pretty delusional, bro. Isn't the real definition of being crazy like you do the same thing and you think it's gonna turn out differently?
Mm-hmm.
And we later see when Belos after Belos is defeated, we get Belos back to normal form. He tries to say he was cursed by
that
dark magic.
That was so good.
Yeah. That was great.
Stands there silently. Someone I saw again on friggin' Twitter, they were like, because she still had the Titan magic, what if she was the one who made the acid rain start?
Whoa! I love that the acid rain didn't even hurt her. I was like,
I know, it was sparkling. That looked so anime to me. That was the most anime part.
Just then after he was already like mostly dissolved, it stopped. So that she accomplished what she needed to dissolve
the will of the Titan. I don't know, something like that.
I love that.
Weirdly, in our Belos checklist, you know, like more backstory, no, more Grimwalker explanation, no, but we kind of did get number three, like more explanation on Belos's motives, because he really re-emphasized that I just hate witches, like,
yeah, I just want to kill everyone.
So we did get a little bit of something, I think, for that third one.
He wanted he reaffirmed to purge his motives, that land, and I was like, but dude, you're turning into a Titan, like,
you're like full of Titan magic, bro. It's the only thing that's kept you alive for 200 years.
Right.
I did like seeing him in normal form one last time. I also, you know, not to continue complaining about Bell stuff, I also would have liked to see Caleb again. We did see him last episode. I think that would have been nice. Caleb's ghost comes down when Belos is dying.
I think that was like part of the sacrifice, though. Like, like we didn't get the Evelyn stuff, so we don't get Caleb either.
Oh, it's all connected. Okay. Yeah. As a couple, they were sacrificed for the season, the shortened season three.
At least they were sacrificed together.
Oh, that's so sweet. They were sacrificed together to the Disney gods. Yeah,
for the good of the story.
to the good of the
or
Disney
detriment,
timeline.
Arguably.
Yeah. The episode.
Okay, but then we get Luz in, what do we call this? Titan form Luz, Titan magic power Luz.
We have to, okay, what did they call it with Anne and Amphibia? Did it have a name?
Like that, right?
Saiyan.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Super Saiyan. Yeah. That doesn't really work here, I guess.
I just feel like it's Luz's Titan form.
Yeah.
It's like her boiling Luz. Isles form. Yeah.
First cursed form, like Ida, you know.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, they look so similar. I loved that there was like elements of like King, and there was elements of Ida in her like her super form. Because like she had like the little like snaggle tooth like Ida does, but there was like the bones.
And she had the black eyes. Like, I don't know what they're called, not the pupils.
Oh, well, the whenever opposite. They're... she's in her like harpy form, like so she had like the blacked out eyes and then like all of the bone elements for like King, and I was like, this is beautiful, like
it looks so good. The glyphs too that were like just in the air, it was giving really like magical girl.
I love the glyphs in the air, the visuals surrounding that the trio kind of fought together originally against Kaiju Belos.
Yes.
They were all helping her, and Rain was there too, because it's an honorary member.
Yeah, like Rain was also there, during all the
At the tour.
Not Amity, though. Not allowed to be Amity, but.
She had to help everyone else in the archives.
Yeah, Amity was helping in the archives, and then they go inside to the hearts, and Luz has the big, dramatic, biggest animation scene of the episode.
I loved that.
The callback was obviously the best thing.
Yes.
Luz rips Belos off of the Titan art.
And I love, you can see, the magic almost, breaking, with all of the glyphs or whatever. Oh, yeah. So beautiful.
There were a lot of very lovingly animated, I think even more like sections in this one than the rest of the season, which is saying something.
I know. The whole thing before this with when Luz is in Titan form, I think all of that is specially animated probably. And then this scene for sure is super specially animated. And Luz, of course, Luz says, now eat this sucker.
Yes. They did that every season.
I'm so happy. It's so good. It's the best line.
She's not allowed to be too cool. That's my interpretation.
Well,
what do you mean that was so cool?
It was finally getting cool.
It's cool in a Luz. It's cool in a Luz way, but it's
a Luz way. I love whenever she came back and she's like, "I'm back," and she's like, "No, wait, no, that's not what I wanted to say."
Yeah, I like that too. Yeah, the show has always had a great handle on Luz's dorkiness. It's really one of the strongest parts. Yeah,
bet you thought you saw the last of me.
Any other favorite parts of or commentary on the Titan Luz stuff?
I like the From the Heart reference also.
Oh, yes.
You know where magic comes from. Cute. What else? the archive stuff.
Was any of this people's favorite scenes of the finale?
No, mine's the epilogue still.
I know. Other than the epilogue, it's kind of separate.
I did really love the like Titan Luz scene.
Yeah.
And I know that they were like specially animated and stuff like that, but they were just so like, I don't know, just fun to watch. And
I feel like it was like a double gut punch. Like first you see her like turning into fungus, talking to the collector, and you see like Ida and King getting real pissed, which that was awesome.
Oh, yeah.
They got so pissed.
When Ida says, I need you to get away because I can't control myself right now.
That was so good. I was
like, get her, mom.
Also, I forgot, if you go back to the in-between space with Luz on the Titan, he's like, you don't want to get depressed because then you'll fall down and really be dead.
Yeah, because
she was sort of connect dots. He pulled her out.
That's insane to me.
And she started to like slowly sink, and I was like, oh, I love this, even though it's very dark.
Let's let Luz be dead for real. How far can this go?
It just adds a nice element to it.
Yeah. Any other, anything we haven't talked about that's jumping out? There's a few other stuff from the beginning, but anything else?
Can we talk about the beginning?
So they're trapped. Luz Other and King are trapped in the collector's dream games type of thing. Everyone's mad at them in their
lives. Which is hilarious because it's Belos. It was Belos's idea. Like, put them in a nightmare where everyone they love is mad at them.
God,
that'll teach them their lesson.
Put them in my personal hell. Then they'll get it.
Yeah, I like Amity trying to face off with Luz with the witches.
Oh yeah, the fact that Luz knows it's not her because she doesn't get it right.
Mm-hmm.
Nerd.
She's like, well, you look like Amity, but
you're not nerdy enough.
Yeah,
you would never mistake a quote directly from that book series
that we both.
At the end, that's like most of what Luz is bringing to college is like,
stuff.
That's very real.
A lifelong commitment. Okay,
has not grown up in 4 years.
I
took my Avatar poster to college with me. Come on,
nice. Well, yeah, you know that statue's like the $200 version.
Like mom got it for her for a birthday. She's like, you've been helping out with the boy aisle so much. Here's this $200 statue you've been wanting.
Yeah, does she get paid for helping out with the reconstruction?
No.
I don't think so. Does that count as her like high school community service? What if she tries to turn
that? That's what I would put it. I helped rebuild a destroyed community. Third world
I guess
community.
Be vague about it. Yeah. they also a sequence of them playing the collector's favorite games, Pac-Man, marbles, and Jenga.
I loved that, like, most of the games were just, like, super old school games, like Jenga,
marbles.
Why does
the collector
marbles?
Know all these things?
What if they just... What if
but he's so young, so he's not well-versed on modern games.
What if you just put them in Super Smash Bros. Fight to the death?
Fight to the death.
That's kind of what happened, I feel like. Final form.
But I also appreciated that in true childhood fashion, it was whenever the collector lost is whenever that game ended and the next game started. Like, I just lost. No, you're not playing fair. We're going to play a new game.
Child energy.
Yes.
Yeah, that's nice. And then the only other thing is there's a lot of stuff about like Rain resisting Belos.
Belos was still around in the beginning. So powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I just feel so bad for them. They did not deserve any of that.
I mean, they didn't, but that means we got more of them. Which,
there's a lot. There's a lot of rain.
Be like that, but I don't know. They had stuff to do with the finale.
But also, if Rain can like just have such a powerful blast from just whistling,
right? Oh my god,
that's a lot of power.
Very strong.
Because most bards need some type of instrument, but just to use your own wrist. Very strong
like ox.
I want Ida to just have like a Rain appreciation day where Ida's like, Rain, show me all like
that's
the
every
cool,
day for
strong
Ida,
stuff
though.
Yeah, you can do
every day.
Michelle, anything else top of mind from the finale?
It was really good. I want to rewatch it a few times. Like, one thing I really appreciated was like I think the music was exceptionally good this time. I mean, like, not that it's never not good, but like, I think especially like when it was doing like more subtle moments, more emotional beats, like they really...
I liked the variations on the theme.
Yeah, the epilogue variation was like so good. I can't wait till it's released. I could just listen to
it. There was a guitar riff.
When they were turning the fungus to the red grass when they're killing Belos again.
And also when the collector's like flying up to Belos to try to
get him a hug. That was cool. That felt cool. I will say one thing I liked, but like I didn't know I was gonna like it till it happened, was the fact that, because they had to make a decision, right? The crew, like, all right, who's gonna like be in the final showdown? Like, how many people we want actually doing this? And the decision to make it a King Luz and Ida focusing felt really right, because that's like she meant first. Those are the people that, like, you know, they were the whole weirdo together. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm sorry, but I'll let it go. I think that made a lot of sense. Like, it's okay with me that was kind of prioritized versus having like Willow and Gus and Amy there too, because they were doing other stuff with Luz before. So like, this is her time, and I think that was a really nice decision.
I think it was definitely always going to be those three at the end, but apparently, apparently.
Okay.
I like that it was those three at the end, one of my favorite things was whenever they were taking care of all of the other like citizens of the Boiling Isles, and like Camilla's like drawing all the glyphs for everybody because their magic's not working. And I just thought that, like, I was like, aw, she cared enough to learn what the glyphs were. Like, that's so sweet. Unless she was just drawing them randomly, not knowing what
Camilla knew a lot about them.
She's helping. She's
just like, we got that montage of her learning, like Luz was teaching her. So it came in handy.
Yeah, that's true.
That's nice. Allie, anything else from finale?
I just like in general, because I have a thought about like the more finale, specific. Like general, like the theme. Because I'm very happy that the, like, because you know we were talking about what's gonna happen at the end. Is she gonna have to go back to the human realm or the demon realm? I'm so happy she didn't have to choose, because like it didn't seem like it would have made sense for her like arc to have to sacrifice anything, because she just wanted to feel belonged and understood. And I don't know. I feel like it just makes sense.
Yeah, I agree with you that whenever, I guess the overlapping theme of the show is that it's okay to be yourself and you want to be seen. It seems very like counterproductive almost to character have to choose between.
Yeah.
Like the world where she doesn't feel like she belongs in the world where she does belong. So I like that we didn't have to make that choice, which I know we sacrificed like that conversation between like Amity and Luz about, you know, what was going to happen to them. But I think that it feels better this way.
Yeah.
Definitely like them Luz being able to go back and forth. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
April, anything else from the finale?
No.
That's okay. I mean, it's so much.
I think we covered it.
We'll have more.
We covered it. I'm emotionally distraught still.
Yes.
But I also don't.
I think it's going to take time to process and probably rewatching once more to really fully. Because I feel like anytime that I first watch something that's going to have this big of an impact on my life, I'm very distracted by that, which is why, like, my second watch through, I felt like I noticed a lot more. And I'm like, but I was still very, like, emotional about the whole situation. And so I think that, like, as I rewatch in the future, I will, like, pick up on more, like, Easter eggs or notice these little things or get excited about that. So.
Yeah, but even more Evelyn Easter eggs we'll pick up.
Yeah, maybe. So, but I do think that, that being so attached to this show and then like watching the finale, knowing it's the finale, like is very, very distracting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Initial thoughts on the, obviously it's, you know, we're less than 24 hours, but thoughts on like the season three as the specials kind of format, how that was successful. This could be a whole nother discussion too.
Oh yeah.
But I don't think it was
unsuccessful. But yeah, it was definitely not. I remember whenever they announced that, I was very concerned.
Yeah.
And I think we all expressed our concerns about how this was going to play out, given that we knew it was going to be the last three episodes of this show. And yeah, we were getting a longer time span for each of them. But, and like I said, in like my initial thoughts, like there was a lot going on, even just in this, I mean, throughout the, all of the specials that very easily could have been an entire season. And we didn't, and the fact, even though we didn't get that, I still feel like it was a complete season.
I would agree. I think time was used really well given the constraint of how many episodes there weren't. I think like my only very personal, not objective thought was like, did we need to spend so much time in the school in the second episode? But besides that, I was so happy with everything that was touched on and the amount of time they gave certain things, especially that human, like being in the human realm episode, like that was such a gift I like never thought we would get. I mean, until like the end of season two, then it seemed pretty apparent. But like, oh, that was so good. Like it was so nice. And I think like, yeah, no, I feel like it's obviously like you can always wonder like what if, but I feel like because time was used so effectively, I'm really happy with how things turned out and that this is the version that we ended up getting, because this was a very good version, in my opinion.
I agree with that.
Yeah, my initial thought is I think the first special was like excellent in terms of like you've seen, like compared to what a full season three would have been. I feel like the first special, like just focusing on Earth, it might have been a similar time anyway in the full season. I thought that was like 100% effective. And then I think you could argue the next two ones like could have been done for sure differently in some ways in a full season, and in some ways were less effective, at least for me. I mean, we've always talked about Kikimura and Hicksite in the second special, and then in my opinion in the special. For me, I do think the like lack of further Belos explanation, if it would have been there in the full season three, that is a big hit for my enjoyment of the show. Evelyn. So I think these things, more Caleb, I mean, I think a lot of the, even more Collector too, like what we got was satisfying. So I think Collector stuff ends up working in the shortened season three. It's so hard to nail everything when they have three episodes, right? So if Belos is what ends up being less satisfying than what could have been in a fuller season, sure. I mean, I also think there could have been more Lumity, more Hootie, obviously. There's a lot of stuff. But that's inevitable when you're shortening the season.
Yeah, that's inevitable.
I do think, like, specifics of, like, what was presented not being presented as effectively in the format, I do think the all of the Belos stuff and the lore stuff in general. I think this finale would have been similar, it feels like, in a full season, maybe over the course of two or three episodes. Because this just felt like a normal kind of finale in a lot of ways.
I
think it goes maybe even bigger, incorporates even more things, you know. So I think the conclusion is still great. It's just like I feel like we missed some stuff in the middle. That's kind of where I'm at right now.
Oh, that's fair. It's fair. I mean, it's fair that that's your opinion, at least.
Dang.
I think we've cared a lot more about.
I was least high in the middle, but I still really I enjoyed many aspects of the middle. And I think the beginning and ending of the season, I felt really high on.
Nice.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a great episode. I think it's like my concerns are in context, you know, on
its own. Oh, yeah. Oh, no, for sure.
That's the thing. Without the context, I wonder if like anyone would take this as a like a learning example of what they could do with like.
Oh.
Yeah, but I would hope
not necessarily
so, right?
time constraints, but like if they, you know, wanted to sum things up or like they could put on hypothetical time constraints to make stuff that's not super necessary less so
or condensed.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe not.
I do
condensed.
Think like I can't think of anything that like had such a short wrap-up time that was as successful as this. So like that's very impressive for sure. With my restraints, like I mean I don't think I expected to be like this like consistently high quality throughout and incorporate so many things. So it was like really well done for sure.
It was extremely well done. And that's what I'm most satisfied with, is that the fact that they had these three extended episodes and they were able to accomplish I mean, yes, like, it does suck that, you know, we didn't get as much Lumity, or, you know, that we didn't get, like, the full, like, Belos and the Caleb and the Evelyn, like, story, but, and other things, too, but that, I mean, it's just the reality of the situation, and it's hard for me to be upset, because I'm satisfied with the end.
And to Allie's point, like, this is a good, this is a very helpful example of, like, because it really seemed like for this crew, once they found out they were having a shorter season, they were like, all right, well, that's going to change how we approach season two finale. That's going to change the approach to all of season three. And that really shows, like, what get going really hard can get you.
Yes.
In a way
adapt,
that I think
overcome.
Hopefully will be very useful and a helpful kind of, like, guiding light for future show teams.
Yes.
Just in terms of, like, what, just lean into stuff. It's okay. Like, have fun. Like, go harder.
Do something different.
Don't be afraid to. Yeah. And I think that's like a net positive just in general, probably for the industry.
Yeah.
Anything else? Any last thoughts?
Yay, Owl House. I'm really glad we got this show for like 2-3 years. How long has it been? I don't know. Most of COVID.
3 years.
Yeah. 3 years. Yeah.
3 years, three seasons.
Rick and Morty 100 years. Owl House future.
We wish.
I want to thank the crew for real. You guys, like, you gave us so much and, like, with so many restraints.
Yeah.
Thank y'all for everything.
Thank you, all of you guys.
Yeah.
It's always a journey that we do together. And
that is very true.
I know I sound super cheesy or cliche right now, but it's true. Like, I love that we all did this together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We did it. The whole
we did it.
We did it.
Yes,
we survived.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we survived our final Owl House hiatus.
Yeah, we sure did. God, the last one.
No, it's just another hiatus
until we hear about the
next show.
Until the late night special.
Yes.
Yeah, no, but thank you guys for being co-hosts on all of this. Let me know if you have any ideas for any other Alas discussions. We can always do that. And listeners and hosts and everyone, let us all know if we have further topics for Owl House. Does not need to be the end. We already did an episode ranking, so I don't know if we need to do that again.
I think we might, because now it's over.
Yeah, we do a new one.
There's only been three more.
It could change everything.
That could be very important ones.
Yeah.
Very important three. That's true. But yes, thank you everyone for listening. Please leave comments, your thoughts on everything we discussed. You can support us via Patreon at patreon.com/overlyanimated. Thanks to our current patrons, especially our patron of the podcast, Carter. And thanks as always to our patron executive producer, Steve, Michael, and Phonician. So we will see on any potential future Owl House or Cross Show type podcasts. We do have a more Miraculous Ladybug coming up. So,
don't remind me.
Now that Alice is done, Michelle and Allie can marathon Ladybug and catch up. There's nothing other priorities.
There's a million seasons right now.
There's
right
five
now.
Seasons. It's that's five, it. Just five, just like over 100 episodes
it's
to catch
so
up.
Unhinged. So unhinged. It'll happening. Be great.
All I know is the Dead Wife Garden, and they love each other, but they don't know they're each other.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Exactly. Yes. You got it. That's it. That's
you're
all there. Okay.
Perfect. You're going to fit right in.
That's very comforting.
That's it, yes. More of that coming up. Thank you guys for listening. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.